morning. Today we welcome Sister Mary Ellen Green from Marywood to give us our message this morning, and she will be talking about napping on the job. None of us do, I'm sure. There are a lot of announcements in the bulletin. Appreciate it if you read them and find your place in the life of the church this week. There was one thing that... Oh, just remember there's children's Sunday school this time, right after church. All right, our call to worship this morning is Psalm 9, verses 9 and 10. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Oh, we have no candle lighter.
I bet you we can find a candle lighter.
We found a candle lighter. We'll wait for the first hymn.
So I'll just make some music here.
Announcements.
Okay.
First of all, the worship survey that I've been pushing for the last couple of weeks, we've done quite well, but we can do better, and I would just like anyone that needs a survey that hasn't filled one out, I'll have it in the back of church. If you lost yours or whatever, just call the office and we'll mail you one. So, we really want your opinion, and it will help the leadership of the congregation. It will help the next search committee, and it will be helpful to the pastor that we ultimately hire. So it's a very important document. The other thing is we would like to start scheduling again for ushers and special music, which we've been doing all along. But so if you... if you can usher on Sunday mornings, if you would contact anyone on the worship and music department or let the office know, we will put you on the list and we will call and ask when you're available. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Glenn. Our hymn is number 757, Abide With Me. We will be singing verses 1 through 3.
Thank you.
Our first reading this morning is from 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 32 through 49. David said to Saul, "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him." Saul replied, "You are not able to go out against this Philistine and fight him. You are only a young man, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Excuse me, your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off a sheep from the flock, I went after it and struck it and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defiled the armies of the living God. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine." Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you." Then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried walking around because he was not used to them. "I cannot go in these," he said to Saul, "because I'm not used to them." So he took them off, and then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the stream, put them in the pouch on his shepherd's bag, and with his sling in his hand, approached the Philistine. Meanwhile, the Philistine, with his shield bearer in front of him, kept coming closer to David. He looked David over and saw that he was a little more than a boy, glowing with health and handsome, and he despised him. He said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. "Come here," he said, "and I'll give your flesh to the birds and the wild animals." David said to the Philistine, "You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defiled. But this day, the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day, I will give the carcasses of the..." Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead and he fell face down on the ground. And our second reading today is from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 through 13. As God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you, and in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path so that our ministry will not be discredited. Rather, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way in great endurance, in troubles, hardship, and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, guidance, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit and in sincere love, in truthful speech and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonor, both bad report and good report, genuine yet regarded as impostors yet regarded as unknown, dying, and yet we live on, beaten, and yet not killed, sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, poor, yet making many rich, having nothing, and yet possessing everything. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians, and opened wide our hearts to you. We are not withholding our affection from you, but you are withholding yours from us. As a fair exchange, I speak as to my children. Open wide your hearts also.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and always shall be.
This morning is from Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. Jesus calms the storm. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took up along just as he was in the boat, and there were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Thanks be to God.
Just a word of explanation of this piece. It is a torn poem, which is a musical description of a monastery garden. You'll hear the peacefulness of the garden, even birds singing. The second part is sadder and more thoughtful, and you then hear the monks chanting the Kyrie Eleison, the bells tolling and the organ playing. Then the theme returns, softer and more ethereal, and in conclusion, the monks return, the bells ring, and it all ends in a glow of exaltation.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was powerful and peaceful at the same time. Who was the musician who wrote that?
Elmer Kettle. Ketterl. K-E-T-E-L-B-E-Y.
Well, bless him. Jesus said that wherever two or three or more are gathered together in his name, that he would be with us. So let us, as we say our prayers of intercession, let us remember that we are not just us, but we are also accompanied by our Savior. And he also said that whatever we ask in his name, he would give us. So knowing that the promise has been made, we open our hearts in prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. We pray, first of all, in thanksgiving for all of the fathers in our lives, living and dead, and for those who have been like fathers to us in so many ways. And for whom and for what else shall we give thanksgiving for?
For support of friends.
For the blessed marriage of my grandson. Thanksgiving for the prayers of this church for a friend named Dawn, whose liver tumor has shrunk from a softball to a tennis ball. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thanks be to God.
And for whom and for what shall we pray this morning?
For Christians being persecuted anywhere in the world.
For the coming together of our congregation and our community.
For Mike McCain as he battles brain tumors.
For Dave Evans.
For Dale Young.
For Dale.
For Ken Bickerstaff and family.
For all the mothers who have had to be fathers also.
For Dana and her family at the passing of her son.
For all who continue to suffer from the coronavirus.
For those traveling.
For the Jones, Carr, Waukesha family, Jim Tepper, Dory Donis, Nana, and for peace in our hearts.
For guidance to the new graduates entering life.
For our military and their families.
You know, we gather all of these prayers together and place them in the hands of God as we say the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. And please turn to one another and wish one another a sign of peace. Good to be together again, isn't it? Today in our gospel, we heard about a storm at sea, and we heard about the disciples in the boat with Jesus, afraid, worried that the sea would overcome them. And we also know that Jesus was taking a nap while they were all worried. And they woke him and said, "Can't you do anything?" And of course he did. What is the worst storm you've ever been through? Just think about what that felt like. Was it a tornado or a hurricane? Maybe it was a fierce thunderstorm with hail. Maybe it was something that happened when you were in a boat. Lots of us have boats. We're out there in the water, and it can get pretty rough sometimes. Or maybe we're out in a car on the highway. Storms are powerful manifestations of the power of nature. They can be overwhelming and frightening. Picture Jesus and his disciples in that boat on the Sea of Galilee. Anybody here ever been to the Holy Land? Sea of Galilee is not a very big place. It's probably not much bigger than Trouble Lake. Wow. But it's rough, very rough, especially when the winds pick up. So imagine Jesus and his disciples in that boat, and imagine the size and the shape of that boat. You know, a few years ago, the hull of a fishing boat, a real fishing boat, was excavated from the Sea of Galilee by some archaeologists. Carbon dating shows that it was actually a boat from the time of Jesus. Now, picture this. The boat was 27 feet long. It was 7 feet wide and 4 feet high. And there would have been maybe 15 persons in that, 4 of them rowing. We believe that it was in a boat like that that Jesus and his disciples crossed the Sea of Galilee. It was no cruise ship. Their boat was being tossed and turned, and the disciples were terrified. I would be too. So, of course, they looked to Jesus, their leader, for help. And where was he in the middle of it? Asleep, with his head comfortably resting on a cushion, we're told. He was right there with them, but he wasn't doing a thing to help. Wouldn't you have been upset if you had been there? After all, it had been his idea to cross over the sea to the other side. They had been serving the people of the western side, the Jewish people. Now they were switching gears, so to speak, and moving toward the eastern side of the lake, the place of the Gentiles. Sometimes people say the place of the pagans. Some people question whether those disciples should have been over there. But Jesus saw that as part of his mission. His mission was to all people, Jews and Gentiles alike. They were a team. They worked together and helped each other and learned from each other. But what about this? The disciples were afraid. They felt abandoned by their chief. They felt that he didn't care what was going to happen to them. Their faith in him was quickly giving over to their terror. You know, one way to read a story like this in the New Testament is to look at it as a counterpoint to a story in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures. When we as Christians look back on the writings before the time of Christ, we can notice how they, in a sense, give us a preview of Christ. They prefigure him. For example, in many ways, this short episode of the boat in a storm parallels the story of Jonah in the Hebrew Scriptures. Remember the story of Jonah? He was asked by God to preach to the people of Nineveh so they would convert. And Jonah didn't want to do it. He was afraid. So what did he do? He jumped on a boat and he went the opposite direction. We all know the story about how he was swallowed by a whale and then spit up onto the shores of the very people he was called to serve. And they converted. And he was mad. Because God said, I told you so. So picture all of that in relation to Jesus and his disciples in the boat and what the similarities are here. In both cases, we have a journey by boat toward Gentile or pagan territory for the purpose of redeeming Gentile lives. Another similarity is we have a storm at sea, a terrible storm that threatened to sink the boat and drown the occupants of that boat. There was great fear among everyone in both stories. And in both stories, the principal characters, Jonah and Jesus, were asleep during the storm. We hear the other disciples or compatriots of Jonah rebuking them. They use the word rebuke in both stories. Wake up and do something. Then the principal characters, Jonah and Jesus, take action that results in the stilling of the storm. You remember that in Jonah's story, he said, I'm the one responsible for this storm, so throw me overboard. And they did. And that's when he was swallowed by the whale. So he took action, not by calming the storm, but getting out of there, which indeed did calm the storm. But Jesus didn't say, throw me overboard. He just stood up and said, peace, be still. And his power took over. Then we have in both stories, wonderment on the part of the sailors. What's going on? What just happened? How can this be? We have similar language in both stories, using words like perishing and drowning and fear. But although there are lots of similarities, there is another way in which Jesus is greater than Jonah. Notice the dissimilarities between the two stories. Jonah sailed for Tarshish to avoid his call from God. Jesus, on the other hand, is being obedient to his call from God. I don't know if he felt like going over there, but he knew that God wanted him to, and he did. Jonah didn't quiet the storm, but he accepted responsibility for his disobedience. Jesus himself stood up and quieted that storm by the power of God, who alone has power over seas and storms and chaos and evil. Jesus embodied the power of God over all of these evils, all of these dangers. We can say that Jonah is part of our salvation history. And his story is an important part in the way we see God working throughout history. He's part of our salvation history. But Jesus, the Christ, has a unique role. He isn't just a character in our salvation history. He is our salvation. Jonah is part of our history. Jesus is our salvation. So you can see he is in a whole different place as we pray to him and with him, as we watch him acting in the story. A storm can be a frightening, terrifying experience, but no more frightening than the storms that scare you and me these days. Our world, even the safe and secure world of Boulder Junction, Wisconsin, can be a pretty intimidating place. And I'd be willing to bet that there isn't a single person among us who doesn't occasionally imagine a threat, who isn't occasionally a little terrified, or maybe a lot. Think of the kinds of storms that are all around us, even today. The pandemic that continues to attack our health. The climate change that affects our planet. Gun violence that never seems to stop. Hunger, homelessness, drought, violence of every kind, refugees, immigrants, families and community issues that tear us apart. We're never without some kind of storm in our lives, are we? There seems to be no end to the storms that interrupt our otherwise calm and peaceful lives. Does it seem to you and me that Jesus is taking a nap while we fret and fuss and worry about all that's going wrong? Or does he seem to be there right alongside of us, sharing our frustrations and anxieties? Can we let ourselves believe that his care for us is always and everywhere, even beyond our fears and failings? You know, the line between fear and faith is thin and risky, but in between them is the bridge of the good news of God's Messiah, Jesus. God brings us through Jesus from fear to faith, just as he brought those disciples in the boat to the calm and peaceful waters. The disciples are astonished and even more terrified, we're told, after Jesus commands in a God-like manner that the wind and the sea calm down. Peace, be still. To encounter the power of God is indeed terrifying to us, for us weak human beings. To be touched by divine power is to be in awe. If you've ever prayed for a special intention, for a healing, for a job, for a child, and that happens in your life, we don't almost know how to say thank you. It's almost like, wow, we are in awe. Our God is awesome. Again, we can look to the Hebrew scriptures for a foreshadowing of this moment. We have lots of stories in scripture about water. One of my favorite is the creation story in Genesis, where God has power over the waters of the earth. The universe is one vast chaos. And when God speaks his word of power, the land is separated from the water. And God said, let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so, and it was good. God is awesome. Another story about water is in the book of Exodus, where God, in the book of Exodus, and God is chasing the Israelites, leading them out of slavery in Egypt, and they reach the Red Sea. Big, big body of water. Here they are in the desert. There's the Red Sea, and guess who's behind them, chasing them? The Egyptian soldiers. What are they going to do? Talk about standing in fear of how to get beyond that barrier. And then God's servant Moses acts with God's power through him and says, lift up your staff and stretch your hand over the sea and divide it so that your people may go into the sea on dry ground. And so they did. The waters parted and the people went through on dry ground. God worked through Moses with God's power. God is indeed awesome. And lastly, in the Psalms, we have over and over again, we have God silencing the roaring of the seas, and he rules the pride of the sea, and he makes its waves be still. If you ever take a chance, go through the book of Psalms and all the references to water and the chaos and God's power over them. It's a refrain, God has power over the waters. God is indeed awesome. When Jesus rebukes the wind and says to the sea, peace, be still, he is acting as God acts, calling upon godly power, doing godly work. He is Emmanuel, God with us. Even if it seems sometimes that he's napping on the job, he does know what's happening to us and to our world. He does care because he loves us more than we can imagine. He is there for us and asks us simply to trust him. Let the people say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Closing hymn is number 413, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
And this is a very short introduction, so you gotta be ready.
Spirit of Christ with you throughout the week in all you do and say. Amen.
Amen.